Hi, and welcome to today's edition of Preservation Workshops. I'm Michael Shinneberry of the Museum's Education Department, standing in for Sue Taylor, who is the Chief Curator for the New Mexico Museum of Space History in Alamogordo. Today, with Sue's help, we're going to learn how to preserve those valuable family photos. This will be a very basic presentation on how to save or preserve your photos. What does that mean? Here is the technical definition for preservation. Basically, preservation includes all actions taken to maintain an object in its existing condition. It is said that all museum curators should have a raven over their door, not because of Poe's poem, but because the bird was sacred to the Norse god Votan, whose job was to prevent from happening that which was going to happen anyway. Objects are going to deteriorate no matter what you do. Remember, yesterday is now the past. This is a rare photo of seven of the Operation Paperclip scientists that were at a special meeting in Chicago in 1950. They were discussing what would eventually become the International Space Station. Why are we showing this to you? Because it was almost destroyed after it was stored improperly in a box that became wet. Fortunately, it was discovered unharmed and still in its original cover, and was finally properly cataloged. Yes, even museums and historical societies will find strange things. It's not just photographs you want to keep safe. It's all your old home movies, negatives, digital pictures taken with your phone or camera, photos that you stored on CDs, and don't forget those VHS tapes. Is this your garage? Is this how you have stored your old photos, or better yet, your parents or grandparents? Remember that we are always living in the present. We don't think about the future or preserving anything, especially if it's ours. The first thing you need to do is start organizing your photos. Begin by physically rearranging them. Preserve as you process by starting to put photos and other media into good storage containers, removing old scotch tape and glue, and if necessary, start scanning. Begin thinking about who gets what, such as duplicates, making notes such as identifying people in the photos, and assembling other information that may be useful for family members or whoever will be the recipient of your collection. Now that you are getting organized, think how you will find things. Look for organizing aids or supplies online or in office supply stores. Always label and number folders when you are creating a container or file list. To label files, you should always use pencil. Have a good eraser. You may decide to change the file name. Don't overstuff boxes and folders. When starting to put file folders into boxes, use spacers to support folders when boxes aren't full. Lastly, think like a researcher. What labels would be most useful? You are starting to protect your collection. But what are you protecting it from? Dust, UV light, mold, water, and your hands are all threats. Dust is all around us. Remember where you live. This is the desert. Watch what happens when the wind kicks up. There is dust and dirt in the air, not to mention gypsum. That's what the White Sands is made of. Dust is damaging. Dust accumulates, retains moisture, which can lead to fading. Comes from airborne salts, abrasive particles from soil, and organic material from you. Left alone, dust can permanently fade and destroy emulsion on photos. The best way to dust is to use a feather or microfiber duster. Dust into the nozzle of your vacuum cleaner or use the soft brush attachment. A soft cloth is good, as is a camel hairbrush. Never use chemical cleaners. The big culprit is UV light. What is it? Please look at the graph as I talk. It's a type of electromagnetic radiation. Our bodies make vitamin D from it. It identifies biological materials such as blood at a crime scene, can kill viruses and bacteria, is used to sanitize food, water, medical, and biological research facilities, and daylight is the strongest source. Most importantly, UV is very damaging not only to fabrics and other items, but most especially photographs. UV light fades photographs, especially the pigments and colored ones. Another source of damage is foxing, mold, and mildew. What is the difference? Mildew is typically white, gray, or yellow and grows on the surface of moist, warm areas. It is fluffy or powdery. Mold tends to be green or black and usually grows underneath the surface of anything that has gotten wet. As to foxing, no one knows exactly what it is. What can you do? One, for photographs, if you see foxing like the image on the left, leave it alone. As I said, conservators are divided on the subject of exactly what foxing is, but one thing is certain, if you see brown spots on your photos, leave them alone. They are not harmful. Do not attempt to remove them. If you feel they are becoming more advanced, call a paper conservator. Two, for mold or mildew on photos, use a fine brush or very dry, soft cloth to gently brush away the mildew. You can also use a HEPA filter vacuum hose attachment with a thin cloth or dryer sheet over the nozzle. These are effective resources to remove mold growth. Water is a big threat. We may not live where hurricanes are common, but broken pipes and flash floods are. When you have a situation where you have wet photos, don't panic. The first thing is to separate them before they dry or they will stick together and you will never be able to separate them safely. They are gone. Most printed photographs, photographic negatives, and color slides can be cleaned and air dried using the following steps. Carefully lift the photos from the mud and dirty water. Remove them from waterlogged albums and separate any that are stuck together, being careful not to rub or touch the wet emulsion of the photo surface. Gently rinse both sides of the photo in a bucket or sink filled with clear, cold water. Do not rub the photos and change the water frequently. Time is of the essence to prevent further damage such as mold, so as soon as you can arrange adequate space, lay each wet photo face up on a clean paper towel. Don't use newspapers or printed paper towels as the ink may transfer to your wet photos. Change the paper towels every hour or two until the photos dry. Try to dry the photos indoors if possible, as sun and wind will cause them to curl more quickly. If you don't have time to dry your damaged photos right away, rinse them to remove any mud and debris. Carefully stack the wet photos between sheets of wax paper and seal them in a zipper-type plastic bag. If possible, freeze the photos to inhibit damage. Photos can be defrosted, separated, and air-dried when you have time to do it properly. Begin with photographs for which there are no negatives or for which the negatives are also water-damaged. Pictures and frames need to be saved when they are still soaking wet. Otherwise, the photo surface will stick to the glass as it dries and you will not be able to separate them without damaging the photo emulsion. To remove a wet photo from a picture frame, keep the glass and photo together. Holding both, rinse with clear flowing water, using the water stream to gently separate the photo from the glass. Be aware that some historical photographs are very sensitive to water damage and may not be recoverable. Older or valuable photographs should not be frozen without first consulting a professional conservator. You may also want to send any damaged heirloom photos to a professional photo restorer after drying. Remember that as soon as you can, contact a paper conservator, regional agency, or cultural institution for assistance. Immediate response within the first 48 hours is crucial to the successful salvage of materials and the prevention of mold or mildew growth. On the left is a photo that was damaged by water. You can see the spotting. It was sent to a professional who saved it by digitizing. Let's move on to storage. On the left is an acid-free box that can be used for storing photos. On the right, you can see what happens if you don't store things properly. For proper storage, remember to organize and label the arrangement. If not using filing cabinets, use boxes designed to hold file folders. Photographs should be kept in their own boxes. Never put loose photos into an upright box. The paper will collapse and/or bend. Place photos into acid-free file folders or insert into polyester or propylene sleeves with open ends. Put each into its own protective sleeve within the box. They make UV-protected sleeves with holders for multiple 3x5 and 5x7 photos and negatives. This protects them from fading. When storing several in an acid-free box, interleave with acid-free tissue. This prevents them from sticking together, even if not wet. In general, your storage area should be kept dark. Lighting should be with LEDs if possible. If fluorescent, look for low UV versions. Other storage ideas include archival notebooks, special archival box notebooks, acid-free boxes for VHS tapes, and of course, shelves work well for VHS tapes still in their original dust covers. Regular notebooks will serve especially if you are using the archival sleeves mentioned earlier, but are not archival. If you have film, special containers made of metal or inert propylene plastic should be used. For CDs, notebooks with special sleeves work very well. What about memories created in this era that are stored in digital file formats? What will happen if files such as MP3s, JPEGs, GIFs, tweets, Facebook posts, and Word documents are no longer readable? Or the hardware to read such files is hard to access, as is the case with VHS tapes or Laserdiscs? Digital obsolescence is a very real threat. What to do? Practice replication redundancy by creating several versions of the things you want to save. Keep the file in multiple places and remember to move files before the way of accessing the file becomes obsolete. Old digital cameras, SD cards, computers, cell phones that never got their content removed over time will break down and becomes harder to get files removed. With all these things, while you still have the card, remove them. Be aware of where you store your digital memories that have proprietary systems that may go out of date or just disappear. This is important when storing to a cloud or social media. When showing off an heirloom like an old family scrapbook or photo album, use supports such as this cradle. When working with photo albums or scrapbooks, always turn the pages by supporting the page with one hand on either side of the paper. When leafing through old photos that are loose, make sure gloves are being used and that the photos are being turned over carefully, especially if not in plastic covers. If you don't have room in your house, outside storage is a consideration. An outside shed is okay, a storage unit is better, but the best is a climate-controlled storage facility. Earlier, I mentioned your hands can be an enemy of your photographs. When handling your photos, wash your hands first. Then put on gloves. White cotton gloves, latex-free vinyl touch, or nitrile gloves are recommended. Your hands exude acids and oils from your body that can damage photographs. Let's touch briefly on old albums and scrapbooks containing photos. These show various mountings that are used, which can include scotch tape, celluloid if dating from the 1930s on, and sometimes glue. For tape removal, use steam. Some albums used a black paper. To remove a photo that's been glued, test a corner to see if a little water will work. Some glues are water soluble. If not, take a blunt-edged object like a micro spatula and gently scrape the paper off down to the adhesive level. This is a slow process as you need to be careful to scrape with the edge of the spatula and not the point so you do not tear the paper and damage the photograph. Once removed from the album, there may be some residual black paper on the back. Place the photograph on a smooth surface. First, try some water. If it softens, take a cotton swab dipped in water and then rolled on a paper towel to get the excess water out. You want it wet but not dripping. And gently roll, don't rub, over the black paper. Let this sit to allow the water to absorb and then gently roll over again with a new wet cotton swab. Let it sit again and then test with the edge of a micro spatula to see if the glue is softened. If it has not, repeat the process. When the glue has softened, gently scrape off what you can without damaging the paper or photograph below. With what remains, re-moisten with a cotton swab and repeat the above until all the paper and glue is gone. Let dry completely before putting into any sleeves or albums. This is a slow process requiring a lot of patience so that you do not damage the photograph. When removing photos that have been placed in corner holders, remove the holders first one at a time and then gently slide the photo out if not glued. Never bend the photo to get it out. The most common photo album is the sticky back. Photos in these need to be taken out as soon as possible. The chemicals used in these albums are highly detrimental to photos. There is an adhesive on a page in which you sandwich a photo between a sticky coating and a plastic sheet. The culprit of destruction is the highly acidic glue, which causes photos to yellow and makes them difficult to remove. To remove, the best tool is unwaxed dental floss and a hairdryer. You will need help with this, as you will need both hands using the floss. Unravel the floss from its container and use a portable hairdryer to blow the warm air on the photograph to loosen the grip of the album's adhesive. Turn it to a low or warm setting and aim the warm air at the edge of the photo while you slowly pry the photo away from the page. Keep the air directed between the photo and the page using a back and forth sweeping motion so that the air doesn't stay on one spot for too long. I hope you got some good ideas from this overview. There is a lot of information out there, but this will give you a good start in saving those old photographs of you and your family. You don't have to go out and build an underground storage vault like Hollywood has, but then again, you might. Additional information on methods and supplies is on the PDF file that goes with this workshop. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact Museum Curator Sue Taylor at sue.taylor@state.nm.us. Thanks for joining me today for this preservation workshop, How to Save Your Family Photographs. Be sure to check back often because there will be new workshops on different topics. Stay home, stay safe, and stay tuned.